His best for us is always the best. God is not a God of discouragement. And the one thing I want you to discover in this message is this. We have a God who is an awesome encourager. But if you don't know him personally as your Savior, then it won't make any difference. You just keep on living in discouragement. And you can defend your discouragement. You can live in despair and defend it. And you can get other people to say with you, yes, I do understand. Well, if I were where you were, that's the way I feel. But you don't want any of that stuff in your life. You don't have to live that way. We have this awesome God of encouragement. And that is the whole point of this message, is for you to see. He's that kind of God. Now, if you don't know him personally through his son Jesus, you won't get it. But if you're a Christian, you're a follower of Jesus, you have no legitimate defense for living in a state of discouragement. So I want you to turn, if you will, to the 15th chapter of Romans. And I want us to look at a couple of verses here in this 15th chapter, because this is what Paul is talking about. And let's start with this first verse and read just through the fifth verse. He says, for example, now we who are strong, well, look at this. Now we who are strong ought to bear the weaknesses of those without strength and not just please ourselves. Each of us is to please his neighbor for his good, to his edification. That doesn't mean just to bow down to everything, but have to look out for what's best for him. Then he says, for even Christ did not please himself, but as it is written, the reproaches of those who reproach you fell on me. Now look at verse 4 and 5. For whatever was written in earlier times in the Old Testament was written for our instruction, so that through perseverance and the encouragement of the Scripture, we might have hope. Now may the God who gives perseverance and encouragement grant you to be of the same mind with one another according to Christ Jesus. And I want you to see how he puts these two words together. And that is perseverance and encouragement, because they fit together. Perseverance means I don't quit, I don't stop, I don't give up, I keep going, I don't just figure out what's the easiest way to go. Perseverance means you just keep at it, whatever it takes. Encouragement means, listen, to be inspired, to be motivated, to be energized. And so he's speaking of perseverance and encouragement. And to hold your Bible right there and turn over, if you will, to 2 Corinthians for a moment and look at this very encouraging passage of Scripture, 2 Corinthians chapter 1. And I want you to look at something, because it'll help you understand why sometimes the same word is translated two different ways. But look at this. Verse 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and the God of all comfort. Now, look at this word. It's the same word translated encouragement on the one hand and comfort on the other. And so the reason those two words are interpreted that way is because of the nature of the people, the situation, the circumstance that Paul was writing to. In Romans, he had one thing in mind. Here he's talking about comforting and assuring and so forth. And so I want to look at it in the light of encouragement, because if I'm comforted, I'm being encouraged. If I'm encouraged, I'm being comforted in whatever that situation might be. Now let's look at this for a moment, because I want to answer the question, what attributes does God possess that make him our great encourager? Now, you know what an attribute is. It's a characteristic of God. So here's the question. What is it about God? What is it about his nature? What are his attributes that make it possible for him to be our great encourager? Well, first of all, if you will go back to 2 Corinthians for a moment and look at this first chapter again, and notice how he starts off here when he says in verse 3, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies. He's a God of mercy. And mercy means he bends toward us. In other words, God doesn't stand straight, so to speak. God is always bending toward us. He's always leaning in that direction. He's a merciful God. He understands what I feel. He knows my hurts. He knows my pain. He knows what's going on in my life that would cause me the need to cry out to him. He's a God of mercy. Don't ever forget that. Secondly, he's omnipresent, which means, watch this carefully, you're not discouraged out of the reach of God. Omnipresent means that he's everywhere, and so he's not over yonder.
everywhere is in the presence of God. So think about this. You're discouraged about something. You can say, I feel so lonely. Well, if you just base your own feeling lonely, 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 you get more and more and more discouraged. But if you think, wait a minute now, my God is a God who's omnipresent. If he's omnipresent, I can't be by myself. He is a living God who lives within us. He's a God of encouragement. A third characteristic attribute would be that he's omnipotent. That is, he has all power. He governs all things. I don't have to wonder if whatever state I'm in, whatever I'm facing, I don't have to wonder if God's going to be able to handle it. Because you can't weigh all that God has. You can't measure all that God has. He is omnipotent. He has all power. Now watch this. If I'm serving a God who has all power, and this God is living within me through the presence of the Holy Spirit, there isn't anything too big, too great to keep us discouraged. God is there to help us through it no matter what. But if I don't know him and have no experience with him, I can still live in the dungeon of discouragement. So he's omniscient. He knows everything. He has all the knowledge. This is why somebody says, well, I don't know what to do. Now watch this. You may be discouraged today about whatever decision you're facing. You say, I don't know what to do. He knows everything about your circumstance. He knows why you're there. He knows how you got there. He knows exactly how to bring you out of that. He has the answer for all of that. He's omniscient. He knows it all. That knowledge, listen, that knowledge is within you in the presence of the Holy Spirit. Remember what Jesus said to his disciples? I'll be with you always, even to the end of this age. What he promised to them, he's promised to every single one of us. As a child of God, you have the wisdom and the knowledge of God within you. Now, he's also a God of grace, and encouraging us when we don't deserve it. For example, when you sin against God, you say the wrong thing or have the wrong attitude and so forth, what do? If you're a true child of God and really want to do what's right, you ask him, Lord, I ask you to forgive me for this. And what do? You say, well, Lord, you said in your word, if I confess my sins, agree with you about it. If I confess my sin, you are faithful and just. That means you always will, and you always have the right to, because Jesus paid my sin debt on the cross. You're faithful and just to forgive me of my sins and to cleanse me from all unrighteousness. What an awesome God. What an awesome promise. He knows we're not going to be perfect. He knows we're going to fail. If you ask him to forgive you and to cleanse you and to sanctify you and to help you to walk faithfully before him, he will enable you to do it. You keep living in sin, what's he doing? He's going to be faithful. Listen to what he said. He's faithful and just to forgive us, and he's faithful to keep his own word toward us. So a person chooses to live in sin, disobedience to God, then he's still going to be faithful, and the hand of discipline will come down. Hey, listen, he is an encouraging God. Thank God he lays the rule of discipline on us when we need it. Amen? Otherwise, you just keep going the same direction and wrecking on your life. So he's an awesome God of grace. He is a patient God. And in the second epistle of Peter, and he's talking about God's patience, and here's what he says. He says, the Lord is not slow about his promise, as some count slowness, but is patient toward you. God is patient with us. How many times in your life has God begun to deal with you about something you didn't want to deal with? You put it off. He wanted to have you go to someone and ask for forgiveness of the way you treated them. Or he wanted you to deal with something in your life that only you and he knew about. But you just kept putting it off and putting it off and putting it off. Listen, if our God were a stern, hard-nosed God, second time you did it, at the end of it, what does he do? He waits and waits. And so I look back in my own life and think, God, how did you put up with me that long? Why could you have been so patient? Watch this. Because his all-knowing mind knows that out here, you will change. You will get the point. You will move on. But he also knows when you won't. And so the fact that he's patient with us, think about what a wonderful attitude that is. That God is patient with you and me, not because we deserve it. We're talking about his characteristics. That's who he is. Then if you will notice, he's a God of wisdom. He always chooses the best for us. Always the best. And to bring about decisions that are best for us. Look in Romans chapter 11 for a moment. And
Now, I want you to look at this particular verse, verse 33. Listen to what he says. Oh, the depths of the riches, both of the wisdom and knowledge of God. How unsearchable are his judgments and unfathomable his ways. What an awesome verse of scripture. The God who is our encourager. What? The depths of the riches, both of his wisdom and knowledge, and how unsearchable, you know, you can't plumb the depths of it. Unsearchable are his judgments, unfathomable his ways. What does that say to me? I can't think about anything that God doesn't know all about. The depths of his wisdom and knowledge, that is, he knows what is best for us at every turn in our life. Whatever the decision, whatever the question, whatever the circumstance, he has the wisdom to know to tell us exactly the right thing. He's likewise a God of faithfulness. And this is a wonderful verse in 2 Timothy. If you looked at it for just a moment, now we haven't moved right along, but you can write it down. 2 Timothy 2. Here's what he says. If we are faithless, that is, if we are faithless, that is, we're not faithful, we lose it, we don't choose to live up to what we know is right. If we are faithless, he remains faithful, for he cannot deny himself. You say, well, what do you mean deny himself? What did he promise us? If we confess our sins, he's what? Faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. That's the kind of God he is. He is a very encouraging God. Then I think of that one of the most wonderful characteristics in the closest verse. You just go back to Malachi, last book in the Old Testament. And if you notice in this third chapter and the sixth verse, he says, for I, the Lord, do not change. He doesn't change. Now think about this. You know what that means? That means that the God of Abraham is the same